Welcome back, participants. I request you all to modify your name with your unique IDs. Kindly please cooperate. Please kindly check and rename with your unique IDs and join again. I welcome all the participants for the afternoon session of this FDP program. I welcome Orko Mitra Kaur sir from BITS Pilani, who is associate professor. Welcome, sir. Now you'll be having sir's lecture. And the topic of this session is alkali activated concrete technology and its applications. I request Deepthi to give a small introduction about the resource person.
I am to introduce Dr. Orko Mitra Kaur from BITS Pilani, Hyderabad. Sir is currently an associate professor in Department of Civil Engineering, BITS Pilani, Hyderabad. He has graduated from Jadavpur University in Civil Engineering, Master of Science in Civil Engineering and PhD from West Virginia University, Morgantown, WV, USA. His research interest being development and characterization of concrete with alkali activated aluminosilicates as sustainable or green building materials, correlation between microstructural properties of cement paste with mechanical properties of concrete at specimen scale, development of models to predict strength, stiffness, and deformation characteristics of concrete, and the life cycle assessment of concrete with alkali activated binder. He received BITS Outstanding Potential for Excellence in Research and Academics Opera Award. He chaired a session, the first international conference on recent advancements in civil engineering 2021 and at NIT Sacher. He received certificate of reviewing from Journal of Cleaner Production, Waste Management, Journal of Environmental Management, Construction and Building Materials.
Thank you, Deepthi. Sir, now you can share your presentations.
Thank you very much, Professor Annapurna, and also Ms. Deepthi for the wonderful introduction and this opportunity to share my work with you. I'm sharing my screen. Please let me know.
Yeah, you can share the screen.
Ma'am, actually it shows that host has disabled his participant.
Yes, sir. 1 second. Sir, you can try it now, sir.
Okay. Ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are you able to see the presentation?
Yes, sir. It is visible, okay. Sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to all the participants in the audience. And it is a great privilege for me to deliver this talk on alkali activated concrete technology and its applications. So I'll start off with this overview of the topic. I'll start with the background of the environmental requirement for alternative binders compared to our traditional Portland cement, followed by potential applications of this alkali activated concrete. Then I'll go slightly deeper into the chemistry of geopolymerization, followed by the current trends of research, the characteristics of the concrete made with these materials, including the mixed design and mixed procedure. And finally, the conclusions and scope for future research. So to give a brief introduction of the necessity for alternative binders, as we all know that currently there is a lot of carbon dioxide emission which is causing global warming. So in 2015, the United Nations organized a global summit, as a result of which the Paris Agreement was adopted by 196 countries, including India, with the goal to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees centigrade. International Energy Agency, EIA, has estimated that the direct and indirect carbon dioxide emissions need to be declined by 50 and 60% respectively in order to achieve this goal. Currently, it has been estimated that Portland cement contributes approximately 14% of the total non-energy use carbon dioxide emissions. Non-energy meaning that particular carbon dioxide source which is not used for any fuels or combustion purpose. So this is equivalent to approximately 5 to 8% of the total global carbon dioxide emissions, which is fairly significant. As you might be knowing that the production of 1 ton of Portland cement is equivalent to 1 ton of carbon dioxide emission into the atmosphere. So as a result, there is a need to mitigate the use of Portland cement and find suitable alternatives. Over the last decade, you can see how the production of carbon dioxide has increased due to the production of Portland cement. It is estimated that this figure is expected to be doubled by the end of this current decade and tripled by the end of 2050 if we do not take adequate measures. So one of the possible alternatives as a suitable binder is alkali activated binders. There are other alternatives as well, like high volume fly ash replacement or replacement of Portland cement by other mineral admixtures. For today, our focus is alkali activated binders, which is going to lead us to the production of concrete without the use of any cement. Alkali activated binders comprise of aluminum silicate compounds, alkali metals. Alkali metals being most commonly sodium or potassium, and the aluminum silicate compounds of these alkali metals lead to the development of alkali activated binders.
Sorry to interrupt you in between, sir. Please, all the participants, mute yourself, please. All the participants are requested to mute themselves.
Okay, ma'am, I'll wait for some time and then continue.
No problem, sir. Now you can continue, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So, as I was saying, one of the possible alternatives to mitigate the use of Portland cement and reduce carbon dioxide is to opt for alkali activated binders, which are formed by the reaction of an aluminum silicate rich compound with an alkali metal. This reaction leads to the development of a microstructure which forms by polymerization reaction between the aluminum silicate precursor and the alkali activator, as opposed to the regular hydrogen reaction that we see for Portland cement when it reacts with water. The inhibitors towards the usage of alternative materials right now are the lack of global standards. Specifically for alkali activated materials, there is only one global standard, that is the RILEM Technical Committee 224 state-of-the-art report. RILEM is currently working on preparing two more state-of-the-art reports through their technical committees 247 and 294. I'll get to that towards the end of the lecture once again, the development of present standards. If we turn our attention to the Indian scenario, last year in 2020, the Indian standard 17452 was drafted to encourage the use of this alkali activated binder, but the standard is hugely derivative of the existing European and Australian standards, and there are no specific guidelines for the Indian scenario. So these are some of the key parameters that we need to address in order to encourage the use of these alternative binders. So to give a brief history about the development of this material, what actually are alkali activated binders is what I would like to share with you. These compounds were first used as geopolymer concrete, which is a fairly popular term these days, by Professor Joseph Davidovits in France in 1981. In his paper known as Geopolymer Concrete in 1982, he has mentioned about this particular compound. Professor Davidovits took out patents on three different industrial compounds called pyrimet, geopolysim, and geopolymite, and used them as trademarks in the industry for alternatives to Portland cement. The structure, the microstructure, I should say, of these binders resembled the alkaline binding system of Me2O, Me2O3, SiO2, H2O, or an alkaline metal aluminosilicate, as discovered by Professor Glukhovsky in Ukraine in 1957. In recent times, further research has been carried on in this field at Curtin University in Australia by Professors Rangan, Walla, and Sarkar. There is also further research being conducted right now by the group of Professor John Provis, Professor Van Deventer, Professor Palomo, and Professor Fernandez Jimenez at University of Sheffield in UK, and simultaneously at Curtin University in Australia. So as a result of their findings, they started the idea for development of a technical committee as part of RILEM to investigate the mechanical properties of alkali activated concrete. As a result, a few years back, this technical committee was proposed, and as of last year, there are 76 members in this committee, including three participants from BITS Pilani, myself included, and two other PhD students from our lab. So we are in the process of conducting round robin experiments to find out what would be the behavior of concrete made with these materials in different environmental conditions at different locations in the world. It has been found through chemical analysis that the primary chemical bonds which exist in alkali activated concrete are composed of SiOAlO or polysialate, silicon and aluminium in conjunction with oxygen, a longer chain called polysialate siloxo, where an extra SiO chain is added to the existing polysialate, and a further extension of this chain called polysialate disiloxo, where two SiO chains are added to the existing polysialate chain. Upon reaction with the alkali metal, a hardened matrix of sodium aluminosilicate hydrate is formed, which is stable in nature due to the solitary positive charge on the alkali metal, which neutralizes the solitary negative charge on the polymeric chain, which is formed due to the dissociation of the aluminosilicate bonds. I have showed an image here to give a schematic idea about the reaction which I was talking about. In a few slides time, I'll show in depth what are the chemical reactions involved in the mechanism which leads to the formation of this sodium aluminosilicate hydrate. So these aluminosilicate rich precursors are usually collected from industrial waste in the form of fly ash or slag. In the earlier days, even metakaolin was considered, but presently metakaolin has been stopped in usage because a lot of chemical and mechanical processing are required to make metakaolin fit for use. If we use fly ash or slag, we don't need any mechanical or chemical processing, thereby the arrangement being more economical. And also the usage of fly ash and slag reduces the need for dumping of industrial waste into otherwise agriculturally viable land. So a twofold benefit can be obtained by reusing industrial waste as raw materials to develop an alternative binder, and also to reduce the carbon dioxide emission, which would be accompanied by the manufacture and usage of Portland cement. So there was some controversy regarding the nomenclature of alkali activated binders. As I said, that Professor Davidovits had developed geopolymer concrete in the early 1980s, and till date, there are most laboratories and countries which still use the term geopolymer concrete, but I'll spend some time on explaining the difference between geopolymers and alkali activated binders. The correct terminology for the representative group should be alkali activated concrete at the specimen scale and alkali activated binder at the hardened paste scale. I'll explain the reasons step by step. Geopolymers are formed, as I showed in the previous slide, due to the reaction between the aluminosilicate rich precursor and the alkali activator. The alkali activator is composed of sodium or potassium silicate and hydroxide in a solution with water. And the aluminosilicate rich precursor is supposed to be devoid of any calcium ions. It should be rich only in aluminium and silicon oxides. So class F fly ash fits perfectly to the definition of aluminosilicate rich precursor. So as a result, when we talk about geopolymers, the reaction between class F fly ash and the alkali activator will definitely lead to the formation of long chain polymeric compounds, which can fit the definition of geopolymers. So we need to remember that all geopolymers are alkali activated binders, but all alkali activated binders are not geopolymers. So to take this discussion forward, when we take into consideration the presence of calcium ions in the precursor, for example, in class C fly ash or slag or a blended combination of class A fly ash and slag, there will be the influence of calcium dipositive ions on the system. The presence of calcium would lead to the formation of a calcium aluminosilicate hydrate in addition to the sodium aluminosilicate hydrate, which I have mentioned previously. The microstructure of this calcium aluminosilicate hydrate or a coexisting combination of calcium and sodium aluminosilicate hydrate are more closely resembling the matrix which we see in calcium silicate hydrate, which is produced by the reaction between Portland cement and water. So instead of a pure polymeric chain, we would be able to see the coexistence of a polymeric chain and a weak hydraulic compound, that is the sodium aluminosilicate hydrate and the calcium aluminosilicate hydrate respectively. So in order to abbreviate, these products are now known as NASH and CASH. As a result of coexistence between a polymeric chain and a non-polymeric chain, it is correct to categorize the broad group of these binders as alkali activated binders if we take into account the presence of only aluminosilicates through class A fly ash, that is no presence of calcium ions, then we can go for the definition geopolymer concrete or geopolymer binders, which lead to the formation of geopolymer concrete. So what are the potential applications of alkali activated binders and the concrete produced from them? Why would the industry even want to invest money in something which is completely devoid of cement and moving away from a kind of material which has been used for such a long time and the users are really confident about all its mechanical and chemical properties? So the first idea behind usage of these materials is to cut down carbon dioxide emission and lead to a more green and sustainable construction material. I believe most of you would have read reports last month that our coal reserves were getting diminished. And if I am not mistaken, our natural limestone reserves are also getting diminished to the extent that by 2050, most of India's natural limestone reserve would be consumed. So we do need to take action to avoid such occurrences. So first, to reduce carbon dioxide emission, second, to preserve natural resources of limestone, thirdly, to reduce the dumping of industrial waste and byproducts into landfill, because that land can be used for irrigation or agricultural purposes. It has also been seen that concrete or mortar made of alkali activated binders have certain mechanical advantages compared to traditional Portland cement concrete. When we talk about the term alkali activated, there is obviously some reaction between an alkaline medium and the raw materials. So when we produce concrete using alkali activated binders, it is possible to have some reaction between the aggregates in concrete and the alkali. In case of Portland cement concrete, the expansion due to this reaction between alkali present in the aggregates is detrimental to the mechanical property, leading to the formation of additional stress in concrete. On the contrary, in case of alkali activated binder systems, it is actually beneficial to have further reaction between the alkali and the aggregates, leading to a denser microstructure and thus higher resistance to freeze-thaw mechanisms, intrusion of chemical solutions, intrusion of seawater embedded with sulfates and chlorides, and also because of this greater resistance to fluid flow, there is better resistance to corrosion of embedded reinforcement in alkali activated concrete. It is also hypothesized that the use of industrial waste is expected to reduce the cost of production of concrete made with these alternative binders. However, I'll show towards the end of my presentation that because of the government policies in different countries on carbon tax, this is not the case currently. Also, to give some background, I can tell you about the Telangana scenario since our campus is located in Hyderabad. One bag of Portland cement in our locality costs around 320 rupees, whereas one bag of slag costs around 250 rupees. And for fly ash, we don't have to pay anything. So we do end up saving cost on the raw materials from that point of view. However, there are other chemicals which are used to prepare the alkali activator solution, which actually ends up increasing the cost slightly. I'll focus more in detail on the cost analysis towards the end of this presentation. Before going into that, I'll spend some time on the chemistry of the materials and how it is different from what we see for traditional Portland cement. So the ratio of silicon and aluminium in the raw material or the precursor plays an important role on the potential for usage of these materials in various industrial applications. It has been seen that if the silicon to aluminium ratio is in the range of 1, then the final hardened product can be used as bricks or ceramics with good insulation properties. For low carbon dioxide cement and concrete, it has been found that silicon to aluminium ratio of around 2:1 is the most suitable. As we increase the silicon to aluminium ratio, it is seen that the viscosity of the finished product increases. So its fire resistance and moldability also increase. And other types of polymeric structures, which do not harden upon maturity, like our expected concrete, can be formed from this alkali activated compounds depending on the silicon to aluminium ratio. We'll keep our focus on the hardened concrete that can be formed from silicon to aluminium ratio. So for all intents and purposes in our study, the silicon to aluminium ratio in the system will be in the vicinity of 2:1. I'll show you two images of successfully applied applications of alkali activated concrete. The first one is the Brisbane Airport, which was constructed in 2013. It has been recently renamed as Toowoomba Airport. So this airport, as you can see the runways and the structures in the visible image, has been completely constructed of alkali activated concrete. So this is one of the most successful applications of this material, and it has been servicing quite efficiently over the last 8 years. The second application which I want to show is the world's first public building. This 2013. So this building is currently being tested for long-term properties of practical application of alkali activated concrete. There are other countries such as France and Canada who have opted for smaller scale usage of alkali activated concrete in non-structural and low strength concrete applications. In India, as far as I know, there is one building which has been constructed on IIT Madras campus as part of the ACRC division of CSIR, which is made of alkali activated concrete to investigate the mechanical and long-term properties of a structure made of this material. So this is the current state of practical application of this material. Now I'll go to the detailed chemical reaction mechanisms that take place and highlight the difference between the hydration of Portland cement and the polymerization chemistry, which is the major difference leading to the different observations that we see in the mechanical properties. As we know, for Portland cement, the mechanism is quite simple. We add cement to water and the calcium silicates and calcium aluminates react with water to form calcium silicate hydrate, calcium hydroxide, ettringite, and monosulfoaluminate, which harden over time and we get the finished product that is our normal traditional Portland cement concrete. In case of alkali activated binders, the situation is remarkably different. There are complicated steps which take place one by one to develop this polymeric structure, which is more beneficial than the monomeric structure of calcium silicate hydrate matrix that we see for Portland cement hydration. So I'll go over the steps one by one that take place to develop this polymeric structure. This is essentially a three-step model which was theorized by Professor Glukowski in 1967. And till date, further work has been going on to understand comprehensively the inherent chemistry of this material. So based on the current knowledge, it has been seen that there are three steps, as I mentioned. The first one being called destruction. In this stage, the bonds which are present in the precursor, that is fly ash or slag, those bonds get destroyed in the presence of high pH due to the alkaline environment. The bonds present in the precursor can be SiOSi, that is silicon to oxygen, it can be AlOAl, aluminium to oxygen, or it can be SiOAl, that is silicon aluminium oxygen. So these bonds in the presence of high pH due to the alkali activator get dissociated. The presence of OH minus ions in the system facilitate the severance of these bonds, and the presence of the alkali metal ensures that there is greater electron affinity for the dissociation of these bonds. So upon rupturing of, let us take for example a representative SiOSi bond, it forms SiOH plus a single negative charge on an SiO bond. So this is a monomer which is formed after removal of one OH minus ion from the system. Now, as a result of simultaneous formations of different monomers like this, there is physical coagulation of these bonds in the second stage, leading to the formation of a dimer, a trimer, and finally a polymer. So, as we can see, the formation of this polymeric bond takes place with additional OH minus ions attached to them for stability of the system. These OH minus ions get separated in the third stage or condensation stage as free water. So the contrast between Portland cement hydration and the polymeric reaction is that water being present plays a critical role in the formation of calcium silicate hydrates, as we know, the hydration reaction. But in the case of this polymeric chain, the removal of water is more beneficial to attain the finally stable molecular structure that can be represented by Na plus within brackets SiO, AlO, SiO, a polymeric chain represented by N, where N is the number of monomers in the polymeric chain with a single negative charge. So the single positive charge on the alkali metal ion neutralizes the single negative charge on the polymer, thereby leading to the formation of a stable compound. This is a diagrammatic representation of what I have described. So if we take these different colors for hydrogen, oxygen, silicon, sodium, and aluminium, this is just a schematic diagram which has been developed last year in a study by Rally and Pantazopoulou from the York University in Canada. So they have mentioned similarly the different steps in the geopolymerization mechanism, being the alkalination of the sialate group in the precursor, initiating the severance of the stable monomer in the precursor, that is followed by a formation of the intermediate silanol, that is the SiOH, and the basic SiO negative with the single negative charge on the monomer. This forms the first unit of the polymer. So continuous simultaneous coagulation of these monomers lead to the final formation of the polymeric chain. And finally, we have the orthosilate molecule here in figure number E with the hydroxyl ions present. In the last stage, the hydroxyl minus ions get separated, leaving behind the stable polymeric structure. So this is a 3D representation of the polymeric structure, which exists as sodium aluminosilicate hydrate, which I was referring to earlier. In case of the presence of calcium ions, I'll show you through scanning electron microscopic images. These sodium aluminosilicate hydrate polymers coexist with calcium aluminosilicate hydrate, whose structure resembles the calcium silicate hydrate that we are familiar from traditional Portland cement hydration. Now, I'll spend some time on what is the current research being conducted based on the knowledge that has been found out through research over the years. As I said, the first benefit that can be obtained is carbon dioxide emission being reduced and also cost benefit. So the present target is to develop a binder which can produce a hardened finished product resembling the mechanical and chemical properties of concrete. At the same time, there should be an optimal arrangement between the price or the cost involved and also the water demand. As we all know that there might be shortage of water due to constant usage of water. As a result, we have to reduce the usage of water I think most of you are aware of this common saying that concrete is the second most commonly used material on earth after water, and concrete is the most commonly used man-made material. So there is significant usage of concrete. As a result, we have to be careful about the consumption of raw materials, including water, that we invest for the rapid development of infrastructure that is taking place, specifically in a civilization like ours in this Indian subcontinent. In order to ensure lesser cost and materials for spend some time here. I am getting one message on the chat from Udaya Kumar. I'll stop for some time to answer all the questions at the end. So please let me proceed with the presentation. I have kept some time at the end for questions and answers. Thank you. So to get back to the discussion which I was continuing, we have to develop a technology which can provide comparable, if not better, mechanical and long-term characteristics of normal Portland cement concrete. As users, we have been implementing concrete technology for time immemorial, and we are very confident with the performance of traditional Portland cement concrete. So when we propose any alternative binder or alternative material system, we have to ensure comparable, if not better, mechanical as well as long-term properties, so that we end up not investing too much money on maintenance and repair during the service life of the structures that are built from this material. So as a result, extensive investigation is necessary. Portland cement concrete being used over the years has the advantage that there is a lot of available data about its long-term usage. Unfortunately, we don't have that activated concrete. So we have to rely on laboratory tests, simulations, and accelerated tests. So that is one disadvantage of proposing a new material. Another thing to this in the field. When we buy a bag of cement, we take it to the field or in the transportation trucks, we mix water and aggregates with it and our concrete is ready. But in case of alkali activated systems, I'll show you shortly the mixing procedure and the mix design. There are different chemical components which have to be taken into account. So ultimately, an optimal composition and a two-part system has to be reached where one solid and one liquid would be blended together to attain the final hardened product, which is one of the beauties of traditional Portland cement. So once there is enough laboratory data, experimental data on various properties of this material, it is going to be used for development of standard codes of practice for greater widespread use of this alkali activated concrete. It has been found that alkali activated concrete shows greater chemical resistance, greater acid resistance, mainly due to the coexistence of the long chain polymer in conjunction with the calcium aluminosilicate hydrate, if there is calcium silicate in the system. And also, as I have mentioned earlier, alkali aggregate reaction is indeed beneficial for alkali activated concrete, contrary to Portland cement concrete. So I'll show you some data on the mechanical properties as well that I have collected over time in our lab. So before going into the details of the mix procedure and the mix design, there is this present scenario to be considered. At present, whatever alkali activated or geopolymer binders have been developed over time, the curing process has been conducted at fairly high temperatures in the region of 60 to 90 degrees centigrade, sometimes even up to 150 degrees centigrade. So the recent trend is to develop these binders at ambient or curing temperatures available without going for furnaces to save energy. It has been found that ambient curing temperature of around 31 degrees centigrade and around 50% relative humidity works well for tropical climates to develop alkali activated or geopolymer concrete in the M20 to M30 grade. It has also been found that there is till date no standard for the optimum mix proportion of the precursors and the activating solution with or without the addition of slag to fly ash. So we have to come up with an optimum combination. And finally, to develop the global standards, as I was mentioning. So now I'll present some data which is being collected in our lab as part of the RILEM Technical Committee 294. We are in the process of developing global standards, as I have mentioned earlier. So to begin with, these are the materials that we take into account for development of this binder system. Fly ash and slag as the precursors. Sodium silicate solution and sodium hydroxide being combined in specific ratios to develop the alkali activating solution. Tap water or locally available water for mixing. When slag is added, due to the flaky nature of its particles, water demand increases. So as a result, to maintain desired slump and workability, we have to add some high range water reducer or super plasticizer. And finally, to produce the concrete, our regular river sand and crushed granite based coarse aggregate. There are specific ratios of the starting materials which have to be maintained in order to provide a finally hardened product which has desirable compressive strength, which is the primary property of any binder material that is used to produce concrete. Without the achievement of compressive strength, there is no way to encourage practical and industrial application of any alternative binder. So it has been found that the silicon oxide to sodium oxide ratio in the alkali activating solution, which is also defined as the silicate modulus or abbreviated as MS, this has to be in the range of 1 to 1.4 for maximum development of compressive strength. Research has been conducted for this MS to vary from 0.8 to 1.8, and the sweet spot has been found to be between 1 and 1.4. In addition, as I've mentioned earlier, the silicon to aluminium ratio in the precursor has to be maintained in the region of 2:1. For desirable slump in the range of 180 to 200 mm, that is usually used for ready mix or pumping concrete, we need a water to solid ratio in the range of 0.3 to 0.4 and accompanied by ambient curing temperature of an average of 31 degree centigrade in the tropical conditions. The corresponding molarity of sodium hydroxide in these solutions has been found to vary between 3.9 to 2.3. In the earlier days, lesser water to solids ratio in the range of 0.15 to 0.2 has been tried in the Australian labs, which I had referred to. In those cases, the molarity of sodium hydroxide varied in the region of 8 to 14, giving rise to a highly alkaline binder solution. The problem with high alkalinity in the activator is the quick rate of reaction with the precursor, which would lead to a highly exothermic reaction, leading to formation of several microcracks. And finally, those microcracks would form a connected network, leading to development of weak planes, which would be manifested as fracture planes in the specimen level. So we have to control the level of alkalinity. Also, if the system becomes highly alkaline, it can cause some physical issues for the field workers. Sodium hydroxide being corrosive in nature, if the alkalinity of the solution is quite high and if there is accidental spillage in the site, it might cause skin damage for the workers. So the workers have to always be very careful while handling these chemicals, and as a result, it is proposed to use lower molarity of solutions while blending the hydroxide and the silicate to obtain the activator. In order to compensate for lesser curing temperature, as I have mentioned previously, that higher curing temperatures in the region of 60 to sometimes as high as 150 degrees centigrade has been proposed and used earlier. When we are replacing that high temperature with lower temperatures of around 30, 31 degrees centigrade, there would be definite reduction in compressive strength due to the lower rate of reactivity of fly ash. So in order to compensate this higher temperature, we need to replace fly ash with certain proportions of slag. So a blended precursor or a completely alkali activated slag binder system can be used to compensate the loss of compressive strength due to reduction in curing temperature. I'll present to you this slide, which is part of the guidelines that will be published by RILEM probably in the year of 2023. The target is to come up with the guidelines by December of 2023 or early 2024. So right now the steps which are being followed to prepare the binder and then the concrete from this binder are as follows. So at first, a dry blend has to be prepared uniformly in a mixing machine with the coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, and the fly ash or fly ash blended with slag. The mixer has to be rotated for a period of around 2.5 to 3 minutes to ensure uniform blended dry binders with the aggregates. Then the alkali activator has to be added to this uniform blend. It is important to keep in mind here that 24 hours prior to the casting activity, the alkali activating solution has to be prepared. This is one of the disadvantages of on-site or in-situ construction with alkali activated binder systems. In case of Portland cement systems, we do not have this problem. We just take water and mix it with the cement, as I was mentioning earlier. So at present, most of the usage of alkali activated concrete is in the form of precast membranes. The reason for this is when we add sodium silicate solution to sodium hydroxide, the resultant reaction is excessively exothermic. The internal heat of this system remains for almost 6 to 8 hours after the blend. So one of the options that is being considered right now is to add some additional water, which is required to attain a desired water to solids ratio, into this sodium silicate and hydroxide blend and stir it continuously, and then keep it at rest for 24 hours to ensure that all the internal heat has been dissipated. If this internal heat is not dissipated, then this heat will again cause unwanted formation of microcracks, which will lead to ultimate crushing failure of the binder, which is made from this material. So after assuring a 24-hour resting period for the activating solution, we blend it with the dry aggregates and then mix it for another 2.5 to 3 minutes. And finally, depending on the workability required, we can add some plasticizer or high range water reducer. So the total mixing activity would be for approximately 5.5 to 6 minutes, depending on how much time we require to obtain an uniform blend. These are images of the different compounds that we use and the finally obtained concrete that we can see here. This is the finally obtained concrete. The second most important part of this exercise is the demolding and curing of the concrete, which is prepared using this alkali activated binder. Curing is an immensely important part of this whole exercise. It can be seen that I have provided images for sealed curing regime. We know for traditional concrete that we use moist curing or air curing, but it has been seen that when we cure alkali activated concrete in a sealed environment, that yields best results. So first, to talk about demolding, the demolding should be done after at least 24 hours from the time of casting. And in my experience in our lab, I have seen that in case of alkali activated fly ash systems, the concrete doesn't harden fully after 24 hours. So it is better to cover it with a wet sack or wet gunny bag even after the 24 hour period, and better to demold after 48 hours. Immediately after hardening, be it after the 24 hour or the 48 hour period, the specimen has to be taken out, dried in air for around half an hour, and then completely sealed. If you remember, in case of this alkali activated concrete, the loss of surface moisture is not as detrimental as in case of calcium silicate hydrate from Portland cement hydration, but in case of alkali activated concrete, we have to ensure that there is no loss of internal moisture. So how do we understand that the internal moisture has been retained? After the end of the sealed curing period, that is till the day of testing or at least 28 days, when we take the specimen out of the wrapping paper, we should be able to see this bluish green deposition on the surface. If the internal moisture has been retained, then a formation of sodium sulfide occurs on the surface of the material, and we are able to see this bluish green color confirming the encapsulation of moisture within the structure. If we don't see this color, then there must have been some evaporation of internal moisture, and it can lead to slight loss of compressive strength. So this is a table showing some of the representative mix proportions which are being tried for experimental purposes right now to obtain M30 and higher grades of concrete. The ultimate target is to attain M50 concrete with alkali activated binder systems. So the two columns in blue are comparing proportions for attaining M30 grades of alkali activated concrete and Portland cement concrete. I'll show you a comparative table of mechanical properties of these mixes. The columns marked in green color have showed significantly good increase in strength for replacement of fly ash by 30%, 40%, and 50% of slag. And we have seen for these green colored columns, these mix proportions, concrete strengths of M45 and above. So the progress is on the right track. I'll show you detailed results of the microstructural as well as the mechanical properties. So to begin with the chemistry of the systems that form these alkali activated binders, it has been found through X-ray diffraction that the major phases present in fly ash, in the unreacted fly ash as well as the unreacted slag for two different silicate moduli are quartz, that is SiO2, and also this compound called mullite, which is Al2O3 and SiO2 existing together. So X-ray diffraction has been conducted to identify the mineralogy, specifically the presence of crystalline and amorphous phases in the raw material as well as in the hardened paste. It has been seen that upon the activation of fly ash or slag with the alkali, a compound called analcime, represented by this symbol AN, has been formed. It has sodium aluminosilicate hydrate composition, NaAlSi2O5H2O. It is formed in the vicinity of this 27 degree diffraction on the 2 theta scale of the X-ray diffraction pattern. It is observed for both MS1 and 1.4. In case of adding slag to these pastes, additional formation of allite, portlandite, and calcite are seen, which confirm the similarity of calcium aluminosilicate hydrate to the calcium silicate hydrate we see for normal Portland cement hydrated systems. So this is a qualitative validation of the hypothesis which was made earlier. I'll show quantitative calculations of these as well through elemental analysis in a short while. Now, it has to be kept in mind that X-ray diffraction is just a qualitative technique which provides only the mineralogical characteristics of the system. We are not able to get any other information out of it. So to follow this up, Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, FTIR, has been conducted to identify what are the bonds present and what is the theoretical extent of chemical shift of the chemical reactions which are taking place. So for, again, two different MS moduli, the FTIR spectra has been presented here. So in case of the hardened paste, it has been seen that symmetrical stretching of water OH bonds are observed here around the 3500 range of wave number in centimeter inverse. Then amorphous glass SiOSi has been seen. So SiOSi is something which we have seen earlier as one of the siloxo bonds which are present in alkali activated binder systems. And also we can confirm the presence of SiO, which is the silent bond which I was referring to earlier, which is formed as a result of the presence of SiO2 or quartz in the precursor. In addition, it can be seen that there are small humps in the range of 950 to 1000 wave number inverse. So these correspond to calcium aluminosilicate hydrate and sodium aluminosilicate hydrate matrices. It is also interesting to note that the wave number absorption spectra for calcium silicate hydrate produced by Portland cement hydration lies in the same region. So once again, we are coming back to the discussion that the chemical nature of the calcium aluminosilicate hydrate is fairly similar to that of calcium silicate hydrate that we see from Portland cement hydration. Then we go for the first image detection through scanning electron microscopy. It is important to mention here that specimen preparation is a key part of scanning electron microscopy. Without proper preparation of the specimen, we will not be able to get crisp and clear images that we want. First things first, there should not be any moisture present in the system, so oven drying is a must. If we oven dry for more than 2 hours, there is a chance that the pore structure of the system might get distorted due to forceful evaporation of internal moisture. So please be careful not to oven dry for more than 2 hours at 105 degrees centigrade. If I have more time present with me, I usually go for keeping the specimens at 60 to 80 degrees centigrade for a period of 24 hours instead of exposing them to such high temperatures over a short period of time. That also works well to ensure that all free water has been lost from the system. Now, the other important part is that concrete is not electrically conductive. So an electron microscope has to have some image which can detect the movement of electrons. As a result, we need to coat the specimen with a thin layer of silver or titanium dioxide or gold palladium, depending on whatever is present at the disposal of the technician in the lab. Also, we have to keep in mind that the coating layer should not be too thick. Otherwise, the characteristics of the coating material would tend to dominate the characteristics of the specimen that we are using. Also, it is important to ensure that the operating voltage is not too high or not too low. Operating voltage in the region of 5 to 15 kilovolt works very well for normal Portland cement paste systems, but for alkali activated systems, sometimes we might have to go up to 20 kilovolt and a magnification of 2500 for getting clearer images. So these are representative images of specimens made from pure alkali activated fly ash, and then these three systems made from alkali activated fly ash in conjunction with slag. So the first thing that we can understand is a slightly grayer or more whitish tinge on the specimens where slag is included. That is because of the physical color of slag. Now, to keep in mind that electron microscopy is always in grayscale. So fly ash appears towards the darker spectrum of the gray scale from 0 to 255, whereas slag is located more closely towards the lighter spectrum of the gray scale, 0 to 0. In these images, we can see the xenospheres corresponding to unreacted fly ash and the polymeric matrix corresponding to NASH or sodium aluminum silicate hydride. Upon the addition of slag, we can see calcium aluminum silicate hydride matrix, which you can see resembles the calcium silicate hydride that we see for normal Portland cement. And we can also see a coexistence of sodium aluminum silicate and calcium aluminum silicate hydride. So similarly, another image for MS of 1.4 instead of MS of 1. The thing to note here is there is greater deposition of unreacted particles when the silicate modulus is slightly higher. That is because the initial reaction takes place slightly quickly in case of a higher modulus. So they form some protective layer around the remaining particles of fly ash, inhibiting the reaction between the remaining fly ash and the alkali activating solution. So we might be able to see slightly greater occurrence of unreacted fly ash and pores in case of a higher modulus. Now, imaging is not enough to quantify a system. Image is only good enough to visualize the morphology of the system, and we can make guesses of what we are seeing. But to completely confirm what we are seeing, we actually need elemental analysis through energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. So energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, or EDS, is always used in conjunction with SEM, that is scanning electron microscope. This imaging technique, in addition to the elemental analysis, works on the principle that when electrons strike an atom, electrons are scattered in different directions. They are either backscattered fully if they strike a stable nucleus, or they get scattered in different directions if they strike electrons which lie towards the outer shells. This is based on Rutherford's gold plate experiment, which is now credited to his students, known as the Geiger-Mertzian experiment. The underlying physics of this experiment is that each electron in a particular shell has a specific excitation energy for it to be displaced from its state of stability. So each element in nature has a unique energy spectrum, which is used by the software to understand what are the materials in the system. And one of the disadvantages or limitations of this method is that any material below beryllium in the periodic table cannot be identified by this system. So this also corroborates the fact that there cannot be any water present in the system, because you know water has hydrogen in it. So the system will stop working efficiently if there is moisture in the system. That has to be kept in mind. Now, how do we use the elemental analysis results to identify the presence of different compounds. So when we ask the software to identify the presence of elements on a particular point, it will give us the atomic ratios of each element present at that point. By making plots of these respective atomic ratios, we can identify what are the ratios of various oxides at those particular points and which compounds do they conform to. So for pure alkali activated fly ash specimen, it has been seen that only sodium aluminosilicate hydrate compound is formed through elemental analysis, whereas in case of addition of slag, calcium aluminosilicate hydrate as well as a combination of calcium and sodium aluminosilicate hydrate has been visible. Now the important part, the mechanical properties, which are the most important characteristics for a concrete material. So first things first, as I was talking about thermal curing earlier, it is without doubt that thermal curing at higher temperatures results in higher and quicker development of compressive strength. However, this also means that we are consuming more energy, although it is more efficient than ambient curing. So we have to come up with additional alternatives to reduce the use of energy. As a result, slag can be added to compensate this lower curing temperature. I'll show you the effect of slag addition on compressive strength. From the present work being conducted, it has been found that proportion of increase in strength is directly related to the proportion of slag addition. The different codes which are used for compressive tensile and flexural strength measurements are the standard ASTM codes of practice, and the rate of loading has been adopted accordingly. So we have Indian standard codes as well, which have similar guidelines, but since the study right now is part of an international conglomerate of RILEM, the one which we are conducting 100 bits, we are following the ASTM standards. So you can keep in mind that the Indian standards have almost identical rates of loading suggested for these different tests for normal concrete. So another thing to keep in mind, these conditions are for traditional or normal Portland cement concrete, but we are following the same for alkali activated concrete in the absence of anything specific for these materials. So the compressive strength results for different mix proportions over 7 days, 28 days and 90 days shows that there is very good early age strength for ambient cured concrete in case of 28 days and 90 days, but for 7 days it is very poor. So the reason for that is the lower rate of reaction of fly ash and slag at the early ages. Now there is another thing to note here. The 28 day strengths are slightly higher compared to the 90 day strengths. This anomaly is attributed to the fact that there is a larger concentration of micro cracks which develop from the 28th day to the 90 day. The reason for this is connected to the polymerization reaction, which I had mentioned earlier, specifically the polycondensation part. As there is gradual loss of moisture, there are certain points or locations in the microstructure which develop greater concentration of microcracks with increasing slag content, leading to this reduction of strength from the 28th to the 90th day. So this is specifically for when slag is added. We don't have this problem for alkali activated fly ash. Now another point of interest is the comparison between the strengths for lower and higher silicate moduli. For lower silicate moduli, we can see that the early edge strength is slightly higher because of the higher alkalinity of the activator. Lower modulus means a higher alkalinity because there would be greater concentration of sodium ions. As a result, there will be greater dissolution of the SiO-Si bonds present in the precursor during the early ages, increasing the rate of reaction, thereby leading to slightly higher compressive strength in the early ages. Similar trend has been seen for splitting tensile strength. One of the key advantages of alkali activated concrete is higher observations of splitting tensile strength compared to that of Portland cement concrete. In case of Portland cement concrete, the splitting tensile strength is approximately 1/10 of the compressive strength, whereas in case of alkali activated concrete, the strengths have been found to be slightly higher. This is attributed to the fact that the presence of the alkali leads to higher dissociation of the SiO-Si and AlO-Al bonds, which I was mentioning in the precursor. So it forms a greater polymeric chain. So it takes greater effort to break the polymeric chains compared to the simple monomeric calcium silicate hydride that we have in Portland cement concrete. Similar to the split tensile strength case, we have the flexural strength case. So exactly identical pattern is being followed. So these higher values of tensile and flexural strength are one of the major drivers towards the encouragement of greater usage of alkali activated concrete. As we all know, concrete is very poor in tension and very good in compression. So if we are able to find ways to increase the tensile and ductility performance of concrete, we have to encourage such steps. In addition to these findings, there are also research being carried out now on the potential for fiber reinforced alkali activated concrete. So to identify how much there would be increase in the tensile characteristics due to addition of different types of fibers in alkali activated concrete. I have not included that as part of this presentation because the research is still ongoing, and once exact results are available to be shared, I'm sure that will be shared with the research community. Another important parameter which has been found is that the effect of fire on alkali activated concrete has been lesser compared to the effect of fire on Portland cement concrete. In case of Portland cement concrete, one of the major examples given is the failure of the World Trade Center. So the World Trade Center did not fail due to the attack of the aeroplanes on the towers, but it failed due to disintegration of the concrete which exposed the embedded steel, and the resulting fire from the propulsion of the jet fuel led to crumbling of the embedded reinforcement because of the disintegration of the concrete, which led to the ultimate failure. So it was not due to the impact load, but it was rather due to fire load causing deterioration of the concrete, which led to the deterioration of the embedded reinforcement. So as a result, we have to find ways for alternative binders or systems which can provide better fire resistance. It has been seen specifically for higher temperatures that the residual strength in alkali activated concrete has been found to be better. The three higher temperatures that I have provided here are taken from ASTM E119, which is the code on fire safety or fire hazard on structures. These temperatures represent the mean values of time temperature curves for different grades of fires which can occur on buildings. So the interesting thing to note here is what happens between 760 to 892 degrees centigrade, the residual strength is slightly higher at this higher temperature. So one of the advantages of alkali activated systems is that additional crystals are formed at these higher temperatures corresponding to two compounds called acarmenite and galenite, which lead to slight increase in the strength even in the presence of extremely high temperatures. Another mechanical property which I would like to share with you is the formation of shrinkage strains on hardened pastes and mortars made from these binders. So drying shrinkage of the mortar scale has been found to increase with the presence of slag, which I've showed through the scanning electron microscopic images, that leads to the formation of a denser microstructure due to the additional presence of calcium aluminosilicate hydrate and calcium sodium aluminosilicate hydrate. So denser the microstructure, greater will be the shrinkage. In a case of the paste shrinkage, it is noticed that the paste shrinkages are higher compared to the mortar shrinkages. Specifically, in case of increasing the silicate modulus and increasing the slag content. So the reason for that is at lower modulus of silicate, there is higher proportion of finer pores. So there is higher shrinkage. And in case of higher slag content, as I mentioned, that there is a denser microstructure leading to a higher shrinkage. In case of Portland cement concrete, we know that the maximum shrinkage is in the range of 700 to 800 microstrengths. So there is research being conducted right now to develop concrete systems with alkali activated binders to develop mixed proportions, which can produce comparable or better shrinkage strain results. The final mechanical property which I would present with you before summarizing the mechanical findings is the resistance to chemical attack, specifically to acid attack. Out of the three main modes of chemical attack, that is salt attack, alkali attack, and acid attack has been found to be the most severe or most significant. In case of Portland cement concrete systems, acid attack leads to complete disintegration of the microstructure because of the high alkalinity of the hardened cementitious paste. The alkalinity of the hardened cementitious paste is determined by its pH, which is in the range of around 13. So due to the attack of acids on these highly alkaline systems, there is complete disintegration of the traditional hardened cementitious paste produced by Portland cement hydrogen. However, in case of alkali activated systems, because of the presence of long chain polymers, it has been found to be much more resistant to the effect of acids. As you can see from scaling up to the specimen level from the micro level, this specimen, which is prepared from a combined fly ash to slag alkali activated binder system, has only developed deterioration on the outer periphery, but the inner core remained mostly intact. However, as I said, in case of traditional Portland cement system, there is complete disintegration. It is also seen that the residual stress for an alkali activated concrete system containing 70% fly ash and 30% slag was the highest. As the percentage of slag increased, there was greater reduction in the residual strength of the alkali activated system as well. The reason is similar to what we have seen for Portland cement concrete. So when there is presence of K calcium aluminosilicate hydrate or calcium silicate hydrate, which are not composed of polymeric chains, there is greater susceptibility to disorientation and destruction in the presence of acidic environment. So as I said earlier, I will present a table on the competitive properties of alkali activated and Portland cement concrete. I have collected the representative properties of traditional Portland cement concrete from Neville's book. You might be knowing that Adam Neville is known as the modern father of cement chemistry. So I have used his book as a blueprint, and the data for alkali activated concrete is collected through existing research, including my own from my days as a doctoral scholar till the present day. So in case of Portland cement concrete, we have seen compressive strength values as high as 80 MPa. And in fact, in the present scenario, there are efforts to take the compressive strength to even higher, in the range of 115 to 120 MPa for ultra high strength concrete. So similar efforts need to be tried for any alternative binder systems that are proposed to match that mechanical characteristic. On the tensile and flexural aspect, as I have mentioned, the performance of alkali activated concrete has been found to be slightly better. In case of the elastic properties and the density, it has been found that the moduli of elasticities for the alkali activated systems are slightly lesser. Research is still underway to identify the exact reason for this reduction in modulus of elasticity for the alkali activated systems. So Portland cement concrete systems do have a definite advantage from that point of view. In terms of density, as we know, we take the value of 2400 kilonewton per meter cube as the unit weight of plain cement concrete. So we want to arrive at an alternative binder system which would have similar, if not identical, density. So that when we go for volume batching, the quantities of the ingredients are in the correct order of our assumption. Now, finally, I'll come back to where I had started with our discussion. Why do we want to use something which has so much uncertainty, and why do we want to change something which is already well accepted, that is our Portland cement? It is already well accepted as a binder system. So why do we even want to change it? The answer lies in the environmental benefits that we can derive out of an alternative, and how do we actually characterize the environmental parameters which are related to these different binder systems. If you remember, I told in the beginning of the presentation that approximately 10 to 30% cost benefit can be obtained, and we can derive a complete benefit of full removal of carbon dioxide emission by eliminating the use of cement. So keeping that advantage in mind, there are still certain issues which need to be addressed before we can actually proceed with the proposal of a new binder system. In case of Portland cement concrete, it is seen that the maximum effect on environment is due to the presence of cement for both the ecosystem as well as the human health and the resource point of view. Resource being the load on the environment due to the depletion of natural resources. So the cement content is the maximum contributor for Portland cement. For alkali activated binders, as there are different chemicals and different components involved in the manufacturing process, as we go on adding these chemicals, we can see that these effects of the chemicals, that is sodium silicate, is prominent in all the cases. And as we go on increasing the slag content, we can see the effect of slag as well, being the important parameters for environmental impact of these binders. So the main research problem to tackle right now from an industrial point of view is how to reduce the impact of using sodium silicate, which is an industrial chemical. It is not a waste product. Sodium silicate is formed in the industry using the Solvay process, which is a fusion process that takes place at a temperature of 1100 degrees centigrade. It is comparable to the temperature of 1000 to 1500 degrees centigrade that we see in the cement manufacturing kilns. So how do we deal with this problem or this issue of sodium silicate production? If we go for industry grade sodium silicate, this issue will always be there. So we need to find out ways to get sodium silicate from waste resources, or we can replace sodium silicate by some sodium carbonate or sodium bicarbonate, some kind of other sodium compound, which will partially replace sodium silicate to reduce this impact. But at the same time, we have to keep in mind that if we reduce the quantity of sodium silicate, it will also impact the sodium, the compressive strength, which is imparted by the presence of sodium silicate. So a compromise has to be made between cost and strength, as well as depending on the available resources, to identify an optimal mix proportion for alkali activated systems. Now the other thing, the purple bars indicate the effect of transportation. So if we collect materials from specific industries, transportation will be always a key parameter. So it is better to use locally available materials to minimize the cost of transportation. For this particular analysis, which I am presenting right now, the data has been collected from EcoInvent 3.7.1 database, which is available online for free. It is part of the OpenLCA software database. So the values are collected for different countries based on the numbers given in that database. Now, the most important question from an industry point of view is the cost. As I'm part of BITS Pilani, I have access to some of the cement manufacturing plants of Aditya Birla Group. It is the Birla A1 and the Birla Superstrength cement plants, which are close to our campus. So upon discussion with the site manager, the first question that they asked is, how much cost benefit can you give me if I even want to consider your material? So the issue with cement, as I told you, we buy a bag of cement for 350 rupees a bag or 320 rupees a bag, depending on the locality. We take it to the site or the ready mix plant, we mix it with water. Our cement is ready as long as we add a requisite proportions of fine and coarse aggregates. In case of alkali activated concrete, the problem with the different type of ingredients is not only their manufacturing process, but also the inherent cost of chemicals. We can get fly ash, we can get slag from industrial plants, coal plants or thermal power plants or steel plants. We don't have to pay too much money for those. Fly ash is completely free. However, for slag, right now some industries are charging around 220 rupees per 50 kg bag. So that is something to keep in mind. Sodium hydroxide can be obtained online from the food grade category that is used for baking and confectionery industry, so that it is not highly corrosive. that is also quite cheaply available, but the main problem again is sodium silicate. If industry grade sodium silicate is used, which is devoid of any impurity, it has a very high contribution to the cost of this alkali activated binder system. As you can see, it is the most important or the most prominent parameter, I should say, which is contributing to the cost of this system. So as we see for two different silicate moduli, these are the respective costs, and we can compare them with the relative costs of Portland cement. So per meter cube cost of Portland cement till date is quite cheap if we consider industry grade sodium silicate. So we have to find some alternative for that in order to bring the cost down. So the earlier hypothesis of 10 to 30% cost benefit for alkali activated fly ash based concrete systems did not take into account the manufacturing and transportation of sodium silicate. That was one of the problems. Certain countries like France, Netherlands, Denmark, and Germany in the European Union, and also Canada, Australia, and New Zealand are right now providing something called carbon tax for usage of carbon intensive materials to encourage the usage of alternative, greener, sustainable materials. We don't have that in India right now. So the relative cost difference between alkali activated and Portland cement concrete systems reduce slightly if we take carbon tax into account, but that obviously depends on our government's policy when it will be levied and when we have that scenario. As I said at the beginning, that India is one of the 196 countries who have participated in the global United Nations summit and signed the Paris Climate Agreement. So we are looking for greener and sustainable alternatives. So this is one of the options that we can use for a greener and more sustainable construction practice. So now I'm coming towards the end of my presentation. I'll take maybe 5 to 10 minutes more, then I'll open the floor for questions. I can see that there are already some questions on the chat box, so I'll get to those one by one once I finish this. So what is the exact scenario that we are dealing with right now? What have we learned from all the research that has been done till now? In Egypt, in certain cases, in the old pyramids, they have found that alkali activated slag has been used, but there is no exact data on the mix proportion that was used for that. In case of the newer structures like the Brisbane Airport and the University of Queensland building, or closer to home, the building on IIT Madras campus, which I was referring to earlier, we do not have enough long-term data, and also we do not have enough in-depth data on the microstructure to correlate exactly with the long-term data, to predict the long-term data. We can identify through microstructural analysis that addition of slag is leading to a denser microstructure, and coexistence of a polymeric chain with a calcium aluminosilicate hydrate is indeed enhancing the tensile characteristics and the resistance to chemicals like acids and alkalis. So these are some pointers in the positive direction. We have also seen that ambient curing conditions can be used to bring down the curing temperature, thereby saving some cost, and using slag as a partial replacement of fly ash to compensate for the loss in compressive and tensile strength properties due to lowering of the curing conditions. So that is another possible way ahead. We have also seen that the shrinkage strains have increased with increasing slag content. So we do need to find some optimal proportion of fly ash and slag so that the shrinkage strains are minimized. Finally, it is seen as a positive point of view that the carbon dioxide emission measured as the global warming potential for Portland cement concrete is approximately 1.5 times that of alkali activated concrete. But as I said, if we do end up using alkali activated concrete, we have to also keep in mind the cost aspect, specifically for the sodium silicate and the transportation. So it might be worth looking into combined systems made from Portland cement concrete and alkali activated concrete to identify whether a sweet spot can be reached. We have to keep in mind the chemical complexities that come into the picture when alkali activated binder systems are considered. And finally, as I said, the issue of government policies are always there. So if there is carbon tax applied, then the cost of Portland cement concrete would increase by almost 82%. So the industry would be forced to look for alternative measures, because if a carbon tax is applied, then the cost of an alkali activated system increases only by around 18 to 20%. So to summarize all the scopes which I have told you about, the RILEM Technical Committee number 294 for mechanical properties of alkali activated concrete is currently working on these different aspects to develop guidelines for practical usage of alkali activated concrete with emphasis on the chemical, mechanical, and long-term characteristics. The specific objectives of this technical committee are to come up with an optimal mix based on economy, workability, fresh properties, hardened properties, and also the long-term properties through shrinkage, analysis. So as I was saying earlier, for cement, we take a bag of cement, mix it with water, and we get our binder. But in case of alkali activated concrete, there are several ingredients to be taken into account. So we do need to come up with a two-part product or a one-part product where we would only add one form of a liquid to one form of a pre-blended solid. So that is something which would make this product more viable for the industry. The immediate plan of action is to conduct round-robin tests and come up with state-of-the-art reports with global recommendations for the usage of this material in order to make it more open for usage by the industry and the field workers. So the major challenges which have to be overcome are to change the mindset of the industry personnel or the end user, because as I said, we are extremely comfortable and confident with the usage of Portland cement concrete. So when we have to think about some alternative, there will be obviously questions that we have to answer. And finally, once there is a set of guidelines in place, there have to be efforts to ask for sponsored research from either the industry or the government or both to start local projects or small scale on-field projects to identify the field performance, because most of the information which I have shared with you are at the laboratory scale. So we do need to find out what is the actual result of applying this material on the field. If we are able to identify these parameters and justify that these are comparable to the mechanical and chemical and long-term characteristics of Portland cement concrete, then only we can propose this material as a suitable alternative. So with this, I would open the floor for questions. Thank you for your attention. And thank you, Annapurna madam. I will go to my chat box now. And if there are other questions also, we can answer those questions. So can I start with the questions on the chat box before we open it to the audience? Okay. So first question was from Udhaya Kumar. Geopolymer technology using aggregate preparation will be. Can you please complete the question, or can you please rephrase this? What do you exactly mean by the usage of aggregate in geopolymer technology? Excuse me, sir, Mr. Upadhyay, are you still there? If not, I'll still answer to the best of my understanding of this question about the effect of aggregate. So when we collect coarse aggregate from a natural resource, the coarse aggregate is sometimes accompanied by impurities which are alkaline in nature. As a result of the presence of this alkali, when there is silicate in the system, we can see the occurrence of alkali-silica reaction or alkali-aggregate reaction, which leads to unwanted expansion in the case of traditional Portland cement concrete systems. However, in case of alkali-activated systems, in the early age, when the reaction between alkali and aggregate is taking place, the microstructure that is being developed, or the interfacial transition zone which is being developed between the paste and the mortar, or between the mortar and the aggregate, will become denser due to the presence of this additional alkali. So it actually helps in densifying the interfacial zone as well as increasing the bond between the aggregate and the paste, thereby enhancing the mechanical property rather than being detrimental to the mechanical property of the concrete system. So that is my understanding of the reaction between aggregate and an alkali activated binder system. Just to reiterate what I had mentioned earlier, I hope I was able to answer your question, Mr. Udhaya Kumar sir. I'm sorry if I have not been able to answer the question. If you are still there, please rephrase the question and I'll be happy to respond to that.
Sir, one more question, sir. Alkalinity of water decrease the compressive strength.
Yes, madam. I'm coming to that now. So thank you for the question, Mr. Shivashish Pandu, sir. Can the alkalinity of water decrease the compressive strength? So when we talk about alkalinity of water, that's a very good question, actually. Even in case of Portland cement concrete, we should actually test the alkalinity of water before we go for using the water for our mixing purpose. In case of traditional Portland cement concrete, as you all know, there are specific regulations through Indian standards as well as through global standards on the different dissolved content and the alkali content of water. So to answer the question, for this particular system, alkali activated system, the alkalinity of the activating solution in the early age actually increases the rate of dissolution of OH minus ions in the system. So it also increases the rate of severance of the bonds of SiOSi, AlOSi, AlOAl, which are present in the precursor. So high alkalinity in the early age will actually accelerate the reaction between the precursor and the activator. When we talk about alkalinity of water, one more thing we need to keep in mind is that we do not add water physically to the precursor, but we add the mixing water to the alkali activating solution. So when we talk about alkalinity of water, the water actually gets mixed with an already alkaline solution, and the pH of the combined sodium silicate and sodium hydroxide solution is by default in the region of 12 to 13. So the higher the alkalinity of that solution, the quicker will be the reaction at the early age, So we will be able to see higher strength at the early age. But on the flip side, because of the high early strength, there will be a quicker formation of microcracks in the microstructure, which will get manifested towards the later ages, leading to lesser gain in strength from the 28th to the 90-day period. I hope I am able to answer that question. There are two-fold effects on the early age and the later age strength. What are the ways to decrease the ductility of concrete? So thank you, Mr. G.R. Patil, for this question. I will answer it briefly because there is a two-part answer, a short version and a long version. I'll give you the short version here. And for the long version, I'd ask you to contact me later. So the best way is to obviously add reinforcement. When we talk about reinforcement, we can always go for steel, which is coated with some kind of non-corrosive material or protective material. That all is fine. But I would personally prefer the addition of fibers. Right now, I am leading the RILEM committee for alkali activated concrete with fiber additions. So if anyone is interested to join our testing activity, you are most welcome. What we are trying to do right now is to investigate the usage of 4 or 5 different types of locally available fibers in different proportions, adding them to alkali activated fly ash as well as alkali activated slag systems, and finding out what is the effect on fresh properties, that is slump and compaction, then hardened properties at early age and later age. In case of fresh properties, when we add fibers, the slump will get compromised because of the fibers getting lumped on top of the xenospheres of fly ash and slag that are present in the system. Well, in case of fly ash, it's more of a flaky particle than a xenosphere. So because of the presence of fibers, there will be loss of workability, and that will lead to increase in water demand. If we actually increase the water content, as you know, it will reduce the compressive strength. So we actually have to add water reducing admixture instead of adding physical water. If we add water reducing admixture, and if the dosage is not maintained properly, then there will be problem of segregation of the aggregates and leading of the water from the matrix itself. So we have to be careful while selecting the admixture. Currently, research is being conducted as part of our RILEM committee to find the correct admixture for this purpose. Because an admixture, as you know, should only be a catalyst, and there should not be any chemical reaction between the admixture and the precursor or the activators, which can be detrimental to the compressive strength of the system. So when we try to increase the ductility, addition of rebars or addition of fibers is the short answer. But as I said, the long answer would lead to investigations on different types of fibers, fiber clustering, what is the loss in slump, what is the change in water requirement, and what is the kind of admixture that we can add to compensate for these different parameters that I have told. So at the end of this lecture, if you are still interested, please get in touch with me, and it will take much more time to delve deeper into the long-term effects of adding fibers. If you ask about concrete structure, well, a long-term creep definitely occurs due to the effect of load. I hope you are asking directly about alkali activated concrete and not general concrete. So from my personal understanding, alkali activated concrete does undergo creep comparative to that of normal concrete, but creep investigations are beyond the scope of my expertise for the time being. I do not have access to that setup right now. However, I do know there are institutes in India which are working on creep. And of course, Curtin University is also working on the creep, understanding the creep mechanism. So it has been found that the occurrence of creep is a function of the slag content, if I'm not mistaken. But as I said, please pardon me because it is not part of my expertise right now. So I will just comment on what I have read and what I have studied. I don't want to provide any misinformation. So slag content does indeed play a part. And of course, the rate of loading and the extent of loading till a period of 1 year and beyond. So if I am not mistaken, there is a committee as part of RILEM, which is also studying the creep, and they are looking for a 3 year period to understand what is the creep deformation for this concrete. I'm sure they'll come up with their own global standards, and once it is available, it will be made public for us to all refer to that. The next question is from Jay Bhavsar. Thank you so much, sir, for your question. What is about the chloride penetration if the slag is increased? This is an excellent question. I did not cover chloride penetration about geopolymer concrete. So the first part of this question is, we cannot use RCPT for geopolymer concrete because the charge consumed will increase too much due to the presence of the OH minus ions and the dissolution of OH minus ions in the system. So we have to go for a ponding test, which is NT build 443 and not the STMC 1202 that we use for RCPT. So we cannot comment directly according to what we do for standard Portland cement systems. However, from the NT build 443 system, what I can tell you from my understanding is that chloride penetration is lesser for pure alkali activated fly ash based systems, but it does increase when fly ash content increases. However, if there is a combined fly ash and slag blended system, then the chloride penetration is much lesser compared to a Portland cement concrete system. Thank you very much for your feedback, Shivashish Panda sir and G.R. Patil sir. Yes, I agree with you. This is definitely interesting to know the ways of increasing the ductility. Okay, you are asking about plain cement concrete. Unfortunately, I do not work with plain cement systems, but I am guessing the mechanisms would be similar for alkali activated systems. So if you are still available after this lecture is over, I would request Annapurna madam to share my contact details with you, and maybe we can discuss about this topic, and also if there is any chance of any collaborative project, maybe we can talk about that as well. I hope that is fine with you. Thank you, sir. So, madam, I think I have been able to answer the questions which were shared on the chat box. Is there anything else from your side? Because I think we are also close to the closing time, right?
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your excellent information regarding alkali activated binders. Personally, I am also interested in alkali activated binders project, sir. I am planning to apply for alkali activated binders project. Hopefully, I may get some inputs through you, sir. We may have
definitely
some.
Definitely, madam. It would be my pleasure to collaborate with you. And personally, I want to thank you for this opportunity and for all your help through the last few weeks setting up the platform. So I'm really grateful for you.
Thank you very much, madam. Definitely, I'll be in contact with you, sir, regarding alkali activated binders.
Thank you very much, madam. Please take care. And it was wonderful to meet all of you. Thank you once.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
All the participants, now we'll close the session. Tomorrow again, we'll have a session at 10 a.m. Okay, exactly at 9:45, you'll be receiving the Google form. Please fill the form and send back, and then join the session with your unique ID. We have seen today, some of them are joining after 45 minutes of starting the session. Please don't do that. I said already, please cooperate with us for the smooth conduct of exam. Smooth conduct of this FDP, because I don't want personally you all anybody missing the certificate because of lack of attendance. Okay, so don't make us to do that, please. Okay, from our side, it is a request. Join in time, Okay, be punctual. Okay, so tomorrow at 9:45, you'll be 9:45. Before 9:45 only, you'll be receiving the Google form. Before 10 minutes, you join the session with your unique ID. Now, I'll end the meeting. Thanks, one and all.